Hello, and welcome to The Panelists, the show where we solve problems. This is what we're calling the Paxilists, the unedited, live-to-tape version of our normally highly edited YouTube panel show where two teams of experts come together to solve the most pressing problems of our day. Problems determined to be pressing by the people what write them. Today on the show, I am hosting, because I lost the socially distant arm wrestling match. My name is Graham Stark, and I'm thrilled to have you here with me today. And I'm also thrilled to have our team members with us, and I will introduce them to you now. On your right, if you are facing away from the monitor, Team Orange with Misters Cameron Lauder and Ian Horner. They are Team PAX Prime.
Yeah, well, thrilled to be here, Graham.
Yeah, we chose PAX Prime because I'll never turn down the chance to make a calculus joke, but I thought it might be derivative, so.
I'll just write just some demarcations on the points for that one. And on the other side, Team Blue, is Brendan Beach-Deary and Molly Lewis, Team PAX West.
West is best.
Yeah, you can tell because we're in the west side of the screen.
Sure. We'll allow it. If everyone is ready to begin, I will present to you your first deep quandary. Good news! Due to a clerical error, going forward, whenever you sneeze, it instead produces one of the following sounds. The Jurassic Park main theme, not the ba-ba-ba-ba, the part that's da-na-na-na-na, that bit. Two, a recording of me going, hey! Or three, car sounds. Team PAX West.
Oh, God. Molly, I feel strongly about car sounds, but you and I need to come to an agreement on this, I think. Are you more of the Jurassic Park person, or...
Well, I like the variety, I guess. Because there's, you know, as my human sneezes I'm comfortable with, there's sort of a ha-choo, and then there's a kind of, there's, you know, variety.
Right.
Of, you know, sneezes for every occasion, I guess. And so, well, and you know cars more than I do. Like, what kind of car noises, like, what varieties of noise can a car make? Like, are we talking, like, engine grinding sounds or, like, horn sounds?
Like,
or,
if, like, if it's...
when you leave the door open?
If it's, like, the sound of you, like, grinding the clutch in the transmission, that's, like... Or the sound of, like, setting the emergency brake, that clickety-click-click-click, that really fast clickety-click-click-click. Mm-hmm. Or even just, like, if it can be any car sound... I feel pretty good, because if you don't want to freak out the normals, it can just be a turbo blow off, which is just a really loud popping whistle, which is very close to what a sneeze sounds like anyway. So I think car sounds is actually a pretty good place to be if we don't want to, you know, risk alienating people.
Would you like to know what car sounds?
Oh, they come from a list, do they?
Well, all I have written down here is the agonizing gasps of a 1978 Plymouth Volare turning over for the last time.
I remember that.
Slant 6 or V8?
V8.
Great. Okay. I drove an 80 with a 318 V8. It actually has a pretty good sound, so even the gasps are, like, fairly satisfying. I wouldn't feel bad about that. Or do you really want...
What is human sneezing if not an agonizing gasp anyway?
So right.
It doesn't seem like... It seems like a lateral move.
You're absolutely right. Okay, so we're going to go with car sounds.
All yes. Right. Team PAX Prime, do they move in herds, or will I say, hey?
I am partial to the Jurassic Park theme because I don't know exactly whether it will play the entire thing or just, like, the instantaneous, like, opening note. Unless you have, like, cluster sneeze, like you inhale a handful of pepper and get the rapid fire, like a chew, a chew, a chew, a chew, in which case you might get out, like, the entire phrase.
You'll be pleased to know I have no information on that topic.
Maybe every sneeze iterates the music, right? Like, if you're just playing, like, Jurassic Park.wav, right? Like, when you sneeze the first time, it plays, like, the first second of it.
Then, one note per sneeze.
Yeah, a day later, right? When you sneeze again, it plays the next note. And you kind of, like, start to dread it. I feel that would be great if you could start to, like, actually... Oh, yeah.
That does worry me, Cam, a bit, though, because what happens when the music runs out? Do we move on to the next song in the Jurassic Park soundtrack? Do you start back at the beginning? Do your sneezes then just become dead air?
I want to find out.
Like, this is the thing. Graham's voice yelling, hey, is predictable. Dry and it's eventually going to get confusing for many people, but at least it's predictable.
But this might actually get me to dust. I would clean my entire apartment just to find out what happens when the song runs out. Do I die? Do I get eaten by a velociraptor? Is there an unexplainable block of green jello on a spoon that won't stop shaking? Like...
Well, the sneeze is the small death, so yeah. I'd say, yeah, double down. We're on Team Jurassic Park.
Also, what's the sample rate? Like 128? 256?
Ooh, I guess 48 kilohertz? 44 kilohertz?
We can go deep just... on this one.
I want to propose that it's not JurassicPark.wave, it's JurassicPark.mid. And
I thought you were...
And it's FM synthesis. It's not wavetable.
I thought you were going to say .og and was like, well, that's the predictable one, but .mid. Sergio, I like where you're going with this. That
you're
is
always
the
on pitch.
Element.
I am going to need to find out what my control voltage is. I'm going to need to sharpen up my multi-tool needles a bit.
Jesus. Maybe I did the bad thing. I gave him too many options.
Do we find out if we're 8-bit? Also... 16?
No, and also consider the wind-up of the sneeze, for lack of a better term. They sort of... like, it's going to mess with the pacing of the song as you meter it out. And, like, depending on if it's allergy season, perhaps, you'll get more or fewer notes out. Or it'll be, who knows, the melodica version or the saxophone version. Or the John Williams version, depending on the nature and environment of the sneeze.
Also, the problem being is that, you know when you try to sneeze and you can't, but you're kind of, like, there the entire time? Like, what if you're hearing that in your sinus cavity trying to come out? And you can't make it come out, so it just keeps repeating the same part over and over.
Oh, that's terrifying. In your head, it's playing the little sort of wind-up before you get to the da-na-na-na-na-na while you're just sneeze edging.
Yeah. See, at least if it's a grumble and a gasp of a V8, which I'm again assuming is sampled after the muffler. Like I'm assuming it's not coming right off the engine. That at least it's kind of the same sound over and over, and it reminds you of the kind of stuff that goes on in your own head. You're not gonna have to hear the same two or three notes every single time before you can get it out. I think that's why we picked the superior option.
Yeah, I think so. And I think it depends on whether or not you sneeze with your mouth open, like where it's sampled from.
Oh yeah, if you sneeze with your mouth open, then you get the unmuffled version.
It is a polyphonic song too, so we might end up having other voiced instruments coming out of our head. I mean, I have to clear my ears when I sneeze, so that's not unheard of.
What happens if you sneeze, get out a certain number of notes, go to sleep, and when you wake up, you're at a different place in the song?
I have so many questions now. Does gravity affect this? Like, is it a constant meter, or does the time change? And if so, what affects it?
Also, when you sneeze and your eardrums dilate, the pitch will change, right? Because that's, you know, you've probably noticed that if you, like, if you sing or something like that and you kind of, like, change the air pressure in your ears or, like, clearing your nose, you can notice that the tone drops somewhat. So what if you're never actually on pitch? I think this is going to drive you guys mad.
Oh, absolutely.
Hopefully. I mean, yeah, sure. I don't know what happens when I sneeze. Do my eardrums pucker? Probably.
I already yell like a banshee when I sneeze, so this is just a strict upgrade.
Oh, you're one of those.
Yeah, you're like my dad. Just the blue, right?
Achoo!
It's like, so satisfying,
all the windows rattle.
Look, sneeze is spelled in a certain way for a reason, so you need to get it out.
No, you need to elaborate on what that means. What
it's written.
Yeah. Oh, as we all know, the word sneeze is spelled the same in all cultures, just like dogs barking and cats meowing. It's just the same word because, as we know, dogs only know one word, like Pokemon's.
Is it like in the Transformers movie when you have the universal greeting that is like ba wa ni ra na wi ba nini bomb instead of hello? Right? Shouldn't it be recognizable to us? That always bothered me as a kid.
That was impressively close.
Wait, what is it? Do you know?
Offer him some Energon candy.
Tell us, man in sky.
It's ba weep gra na weep nini bomb.
I knew the gra was in there somewhere.
Yeah.
Why can't that come out when we sneeze?
We weren't given that as an option. It's too bad.
Yeah.
Dang.
But it seems
into my elbow.
It seems that the orange side has settled for the stirring chords of John Williams, with possible concern if they are sleep sneezing. Whereas the opposing side have brought us the wonderful concept of sneeze edging or snedging. And I will give them advantage for the round as a result.
Sneeping versus snedging.
But we have further good news. You don't have to live on Earth anymore.
Hooray?
You're going to Mars so humanity can ruin another planet. As one of the first Martian settlers, it will be years before you're able to grow your own food. So to tide you over, you've been provided with a sufficient supply of a staple food. Do you want to spend the next 18 months eating potatoes, rice, or corn? Team Pack South. Whoop. That one.
I've been thinking about this a lot recently.
Why?
Well, the rankings of the various starches. Look, I have some weird friends, Graham. And you should know that. We've been talking a lot about our starch consumption, and while I love rice, I don't think I could consist of being a being of only rice. You need some sort of variety. And while pasta doesn't really, it has different shapes, it doesn't have much in the way of a different texture. Potato is versatile.
I'm glad you said that. I mean, you can have potato at, just like a baked potato. You can have French fries, you can have hash browns. You can have mashed potatoes. You can just boil them, mash them, stick them in a stew, right? They're versatile.
Twice baked. Why stop?
I'm glad we're of one mind on this, Ian.
No, I think we can definitely work with this. And just think of the nutritional components of the skin. Always remember the skin.
Yeah, because potatoes suck nutritionally. They're real bad.
Mm-hmm. It's all on the outside. Kind of like the earth. Mm.
Well, with potatoes scooped up, you are looking at rice or corn. Yes, Molly.
I have a question. As Martian settlers, do we have access to butter?
That's I don't know why.
Or do we like make our own?
I'm glad that still God, no, please. I'm glad that my cough still sounds like a cough. Yeah, no, that's a good point. As Mars is not yet to the point where you can grow other crops, and the Bezos Musk consortium has yet to construct a Whole Foods franchise up there. So you've got potatoes, rice, or corn.
Christ, because now just having to think of Bezos as Musk is kind of getting me a little down on this.
Well, as an American, I already eat corn for most of my meals, so it'd be nice to change it up, but I am open to your ideas.
But I think corn is... Oh, can I ask this then, I guess as a follow-on? Because I think we're going to have to go with corn, but I just need to know something. Are we collectively of like resourcefulness and just general smartiness as the character in the hit movie and book The Martian? Can I be given that at least?
Are you asking me or the host?
The host. John, I got to ask the host.
Now you'll have to help me out here in that he was in fact able to, you know, grow all this stuff himself, and we're saying that you will be able to do that, but not after 18 months of eating this.
Okay, But I am smart enough to do surgery on myself as well.
Sure.
Cool. So if we have a lot of freeze-dried corn, Molly, I think that that's better than going with rice. Because if we rehydrate the corn, if we are as resourceful as a Matt Damon Christ figure, I assume that we can start extracting bits from the corn to act in different ways. We can make our own corn syrup if we want to. We can use the starches from the corn to create other materials and other goods. We could actually start using it as a crafting element to create food beyond food.
I assumed that that was just a long walk towards like making our own whiskey, but that's good too.
That counts though, right? I think that's good. Like the fact that we could make bourbon in space. Mm-hmm.
We could start the first Martian distillery. Holy shit.
Right. And then
we're coming for the crown, Elon.
Sell that for thousands and thousands of dollars a gallon. And, you know, you have to obviously get it back to Earth for it to be worth anything. Or you don't. We just find a cave underground and we just stuff the barrels under there to be like in like another 100 years when you guys show up here, it's going to be worth millions of dollars to have the first sip of Martian corn whiskey, Martian moonshine.
Yeah, the discovery and the opportunity to just take a flight of them. Yes, I like this. And then if we drop our phone in the toilet, we can put it in this rice that we haven't rehydrated.
Right, because we have no use for it. We're not going to eat that rice. We're only going to concentrate on corn.
Just fill our mattresses with it and sleep on it.
Essentially, yeah. It's a million and one uses. Destroying household pests. Anyway, we're hard on corn.
Yeah, we're hard for corn.
I'm glad you brought up the distillation angle, Beach, because that's something that I was also thinking with the potatoes. Because what are potatoes famous for? Vodka. But what is vodka famous for, aside from getting you very drunk? It is immediately available. Bourbon has to be aged before it's even palatable, so you're going to be waiting and just paying for that cave for years before you see a profit. Vodka, the minute it comes out of that still, it's liquid gold, baby. Or in our
case,
oxygen.
And I'm assuming, since they've only provided us with a simple starch for foodstuff, that we aren't in fact expected to live through this, and that there are cameras everywhere, and that this is in fact billionaire entertainment. And I feel we would be much better at our jobs if we were just a little hammered all the time.
Oh, I am a lot more likely to have my pants off if I have had a few in me.
Yeah, right? And then afterwards, when the actual astronauts show up, because if nothing else, I'm wildly unqualified to be flying through space, which in a technical sense I'm doing right now and not doing so hot at it. But if you remove me from this stable environment and put me on Mars, I'm going to be even worse at it. So the only conceivable reason we would be there is
future
to
compost
be entertainment for somebody else.
Yeah, I mean, we're probably just canaries sitting there waiting for the gas to show up.
Yeah, and after I scoop all the potato out of the potato skins, I assume I'm going to, like, I don't know, stitch them together somehow to make, like, a new spacesuit or something.
Or a best friend.
Wander around Mars in potato leather. Like...
such shoes.
Like in the skin of a lion, only in the skin of a potato.
I wonder if the low gravity will allow the potatoes to grow larger so we can have more skin area to work with.
Or perhaps just more spherical?
Yeah, a potato that's so much starch that you can just... You know, it's equidistant. The cooking then becomes a lot easier because you don't have to guess how long it's going to take for the heat to penetrate the center of the potato.
I think we could do some good science before we die of scurvy on Mars.
And get really hammered.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
As a suggestion, I propose to you the potatoris. That would maximize your skin surface area.
That's good.
Everyone please stop saying skin surface. This is a workplace.
I'm sorry. The potato leather is now the maximized quantity.
The exo potato.
Yeah.
Hey, that's an idea.
I would hope that with us being on Team Corn,
yeah.
We start out with the highest liquid content. And so that I hope that would affect... I'm assuming that, though, that they're not just sending us up with, like, just dehydrated corn kernels. We will have the entire cob, we will have the stalk and the sort of corn hair, like, we will have, mm-hmm. we could make sort of Professor from Gilligan's Island style, just build a society anew out of corn parts.
Yeah, we could make furniture, like lawn chairs out of the corn leaves, the leaves of the ear. And
yeah, write messages in the sand, like, send cayenne and cheese.
We can dry out the cobs and we can make centerpieces out of them.
Ah, little pipes.
Yeah, no, we get corn. That's right, corn cob pipes are a real thing. They're not something imaginary.
We'll make a little Mars man out of the Mars dust.
Yeah.
Give him a little corn cob nose.
We'll make like dozens of them. You know. We'll put them up everywhere, kind of like a Blair Witch thing, just to really fuck with the aliens.
That one's Ian, and that one's Cam, and that one's Camadam, and that one just have a whole little family.
That one's also Cam, and that one's also Cam.
That one was Cam. Bye.
It's good to see you've already succumbed to space madness. I mean, it's a little difficult when you have little to do but eat your corn and dream of smoking your corn leaves in your corn cob pipe. Cam, we're going to be very cultured individuals on Mars. In fact, we might even be creating some of our own culture. What's your favorite wind instrument?
I would have to go with the recorder I was given in fifth grade, Ian.
Well, I'd have to say, you're going to be excited to find out that you can make wind instruments out of potatoes.
But that's who right. will I torture?
Well, I mean, we do have each other for at least the first few months, if this does get funded.
Oh, I feel that since this may devolve into a PvP situation, that I should go with a bassoon or perhaps bass clarinet.
I'm sure we can get a few potatoes stuck together in tube form.
You know, something that I can, like, parry, block with. But yeah, no, that's very strong. I like it a lot.
Yeah, let's get working on our embouchures.
If you're going to have woodwinds, you're going to need reeds. And you know where you're going to get reeds from other than actual reeds? Corn stalks.
I'm sure we could fashion a crude reed out of a bone.
Whose bone?
That will be good viewing, won't it?
I appreciate that Team Orange has determined that they're part of some sort of reality TV show, and indeed are determined to put on a good show. Whereas Team Blue have not only recreated, or intend rather, to recreate every part of society up to and including the U.S. corn subsidies, where they make corn out of, or they make everything out of corn. So I think given that, we will give the edge to Team Orange on that question. But we will move
on.
Can
we make Martian ethanol?
I can't imagine why not, since we just assumed you could make all of these alcohols.
All right.
But don't worry, I have more good news. You are at a wedding. Bad news, it is the wedding of two truly awful people. Good news, you are fair folk, aka the Fae, or fairies, and you are here to make sure things turn out real fair for these assholes. So, how are you going to hex up these narcissists' nuptials? The mother-in-law wears white and the bride transforms into a pile of cobras after the kiss. The venue is double booked and also hosting a monster truck rally in the parking lot. Or the wedding is crashed by Limp Bizkit, who are attempting to film a viral comeback video. Team, my left.
Molly,
monster truck rally or Limp Bizkit?
Yeah, monster truck rally sounds really good. And that Limp Bizkit thing, I care not for their music, mostly because I've never heard it. It's
hence the need for a viral comeback.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, what if they like, if these are some truly terrible people, what if they like Limp Bizkit? Bizkit, I guess I should be saying, with overpronouncing the Z. And maybe to them it's like fucking GNR's November Rain to them, right? That it's like, oh my god, we're gonna get a video made of our wedding for free, and it's gonna be a music video that everyone's gonna see, and we're gonna get to see us get married, and like maybe what we need to do is drown out the vows with rum rum rum, with a lot of, you know, aforementioned sneezing, as it were, I guess.
Yeah, because you think of, if we're trying to, because you're absolutely right, we should divert attention away from the asshole bride and groom. Mm. And if Limp Bizkit crashes the wedding, then the only extra people at their wedding are the members of Limp Bizkit, and I assume their social team. Whereas if a monster truck rally shows up, you have the trucks, the drivers of the trucks, the technicians of the trucks, and the people coming to watch the trucks stomp on other trucks.
It is Sunday, 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 after all.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so I would think, it would drown out the string quartet, I would say, and the cover band, like the different cover band that is doing the reception, and it would make all the photos all, like the video all nasty. The drone shots would look good, but apart from that, I think the wedding would be irrecoverable.
Yeah, you get to like, and including the ability for like the trucks to just ramp over and land on the rental limousine. Mm-hmm. That has the just married, but some sort of cute variation that married couples put on the back of a thing when they want to really call attention to themselves.
Oh, and parking at a wedding sucks anyway.
Yeah, and now it's going to just get even worse. Yeah. You'll never be able to get out of the parking lot. It'll be like trying to have a wedding at like a corner store bank. Yeah, Monster Truck Rally it is.
All right, well, this Sunday, 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 the Monster Truck Rally will be hacking up the wedding for Blue Team, but over in PAX East, what are you going to go with?
So here's the thing about curses, is that a curse isn't just a bad thing that happens to you. It's got to be sent as a message. And while Limp Bizkit showing up and maybe doing a music video is a bit of a, it's a bit of a bad thing. It's actually quite a terrible thing. But it doesn't say fairies have cursed me. What does say fairies have cursed me is the bride turning into snakes at the feet of a white mother after the first
Yeah, case. Like, do the snakes, if you manage to keep them all together, like in an aquarium or a ball, do they retain the gestalt personality and intelligence of the bride? Does one of them speak for that said intelligence? Right? Is there a prime snake?
As I would say, as fairy folk, I would say that yes, we do actually split that person into a gestalt being of snakes.
And I think it's safe to say that's your call to make as the fairies in question.
Ooh, I like that a lot. Like, the narcissistic groom has to care for and provide for this cobra, who is also very narcissistic now, but now is narcissistic about being a cobra, being many cobras. Ooh, we can work with this. Also, just can you imagine if the less worst thing to happen to you at your own wedding is that your mother-in-law shows up wearing white? Like, that just being a footnote. Like, I assume that the groom learned this behavior from his mother. And if the mother gets upstaged by the bride, oh, yeah, no, this is good.
This is, gonna be very
this is just like nested layers of awful.
It's, yeah, it's like a minor thing than a major thing, isn't it? Like, Deborah the Cobras just kind of turns into this weird writhing mass within her, like, off the shoulder, backless, satiny, whatever dress thing that she's wearing. I'm going to assume it's like that. It really, like, it's a little too daring. It's the kind of thing that it's like, oh, I don't know where to look when I talk to the bride, that kind of dress then. So you can see a lot of snakes.
And it's probably, if these people are the assholes as described, it's probably a large, it's got a voluminous train.
Yeah.
You know? And so there's just kind of snakes up from under the sateen. Though the thing, again, going on the theme that they are assholes, this is probably an outdoor wedding in the middle of summer, because that's the kind of thing assholes do. And so, as fae folk, I would hope that in this double booking, the Monster Truck Rally, we have control of the timing of, like, when, like, apart from, you know, obviously it being Sunday, how do we get the two things to intersect? The Instagram-friendly outdoor ceremony and the monster truck pull?
Yeah, because...
Like, what is the drop?
You definitely, like, it's got... If it's going on all afternoon, like, going on simultaneously is great, but it's way more interesting if every time they open their mouths, it sounds like they're the ones engine screaming. Like, they're trying to say something. They have to repeat themselves two or three times. I think also that level of frustration is more interesting because you really get to see who people are at that point. Where if you're trying to say something and then somebody cuts in while you're trying to say something with, like, something else, it gets to be like, I'll be quiet. Okay, I'll be quiet. Okay, like that kind of thing over and over. Eventually you get to see the kind of way that they treat their waiters, I think. Whereas if you turn someone to snakes, it's kind of like it's one and done. It's obvious that something magical has occurred, but it's kind of like, it's all snakes. And then, but where do you go from there? Whereas with the monster truck rally, you can really, like, drag that shit out for an hour.
Mm-hmm. And the worst weddings are the kinds where everybody else involved makes it about them, like... You know, those are like when the groom's speeches are terrible, when they're just talking about how great and funny they are. And I imagine, like, and now the groom's sister will sing that one song from The Twilight that gets sung at every wedding. And, like, I have got every day awake. Like, any musical number, any long speech.
It's not even that it's been ruined, right?
Motocross nonsense. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like it's only been partially ruined. You still have to hear the song, which you don't want to hear, but now you have to, like, you can't just kind of go along with it. You have to, like, punctuate it at inopportune moments to hear trash that's, like, intermittent. You know, you make it unpredictable.
Yeah, it's a club sandwich of poor taste.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whereas snakes is just like, human beings are adaptable. You can get used to anything. If you want to have sex with a pile of snakes on your wedding night, the groom will find a way to be into that. It's really just all about him as it is, right?
Yeah, if anything, if I got turned into a pile of snakes on my wedding day, I'd be disappointed that I hadn't been turned into a pile of snakes during my bachelorette party.
This is
right?
What it took.
I think you're thinking a little bit too small there, though. Like, if we think about a monster truck rally, that's a 1 or 2 day event. A wedding is a 1 or 2 day event. It's the most important day of your life to some of you, but it's just one day, and you're ruining one day. That's something that can be gotten over. What we are ruining is an entire marriage. It's two people who loved each other, who are now too many snakes and a person, who are trying to love each other, and they probably won't be able to, because this sort of stuff doesn't happen to good people.
I would also submit that this awful couple may in fact be having an exotic destination wedding at some distant locale that all of their guests had to pay $15,000 to attend. And by turning the bride into a writhing mass of snakes, we may in fact be violating several biological importation laws that would result in the bride becoming impounded
by
local authorities.
Weddings themselves are already invasive. Yeah, if we're just going to dump a bunch of snakes in the Garden of Eden in Fiji, you've ruined their economy. No more weddings because too many snakes.
Exactly. Also, as fae folk, I believe that we could further alter the wedding such that the bride still has an appropriate thing to select from on the menu.
Oh, yes.
Right? What happens at that wedding when fully half the wedding cake erupts in mice, just chewing their way out of the fondant?
Left half, right half, or interior half?
I don't think it matters, because once once it's time to cut that cake, that groom is still going to have to catch enough mice to shove into the various mouths of his bride.
Smear whipped cream on them and, like, it's like the ending of 1984,
It's like being married to Medusa, but you have to look at her.
And
nothing gets hard.
Bottom half of the cake turns into mice.
I like it.
I have a logistical question about snakes on a bride. if some of the snakes do dirty with another man, but the other snakes don't, is that cheating? Does that still count as an affair? Or does it have to be the full gestalt of snakes?
With this couple, I feel that Instagram will litigate that case for us.
And the Chloe
when this turns up on r/relationships, and then further appears on r/AITA, we're going to get value off of this.
Me, 27 male, just recently got married to my wife, 24, pile of snakes.
That's her age, not the number.
So while the orange team is going full snake gestalt and cake full of mice, the blue team is going for the monster truck rally. I was going to give the edge to the blue team on this round for naming the bride Deborah the Cobra, or the Cobras, but their failure to consider or even mention Truckosaurus is going to be a minus there, so we're going to give the edge to the gestalt of snakes on this one.
Hmm. Nature does.
Did you dock us points for not making a reference? Is that part of the rules?
Oh, no, just for not considering, you know, the damage that could be caused by you know, the monster truck rally flaming construct that is Truckosaurus. In sad news, however, your dear Aunt Euphemia has passed away. But in good news, she's left you something in the will. It's your choice, but you gotta take something or they won't let you leave. Would you like an old coffee tin labeled Angry Ghost? And when you take the lid off the tin, you hear screaming. Number two, all of the secret Garfield strips deemed too hot to publish by McNeil Syndication. Or three, a very horny parrot who, unlike the Angry Ghost, will tell you exactly what its desires are. Team PAX Australia.
Do you have a preference here, Cam?
I gotta see those forbidden Garfields.
I completely agree with you. This is actually not even something that's unprecedented. By Osamu Tezuka, the king of Japanese comics, upon his death, revealed a trove of some incredibly horny drawings. And this is the man who's responsible for such lovely children's fare as Kimba the White Lion and Astro Boy. But yeah, no, he liked that big old snake titty. So I can't wait to see what Jim Davis has.
Yeah, like, I just have to know. I don't even want to know, but I couldn't possibly not know given the opportunity.
I can't wait to see what happens when John actually gives that litter of babies.
Oh, yeah, when he delivers his litter of puppies?
Yeah.
Because we're going to see it.
It's in canon.
Yeah. Oh, yo. Oh.
So, Beej and Molly, then. Screaming Tanner, thirsty bird.
We don't have to feed a tin, but all the tin does is scream?
When you open it.
Well, yeah, and the operant is when. We don't gotta open this tin.
Oh, yeah.
Because we can't control when that bird says things. And frankly, I don't want to know how it learned any of those phrases, and I don't want to be responsible for them. It would make Zoom calls more interesting, I guess.
My alternate thought, though, is that the angry ghost clearly lives in the tin, because if you open it up, you hear screaming, but if you close it and then you open it up again, I'm assuming you will just continue to hear screaming, right? It's that the tin is haunted by an angry ghost and it just screams. Mm-hmm. And I'm guessing not like torment, just like that kind of mad anger that you fear, like that Dave Bautista will just like point at you one day, and it's like you'll just silently soil yourself and realize that it's like, I've done something terribly wrong. The Beast Raban is very upset. Whereas with the parrot, we could use that for all manner of creative harassment. People who are like trying to go to sleep and you just put the parrot outside their window, they'll just low-level hear this and think it's either their neighbors or that it's something else going on outside.
Yeah, probably want a finger. Yeah, it's... That is true, though I think I'd be hesitant to open the tin with the angry ghost in it. Just because I assume then the ghost would escape and be angry elsewhere. But if it is literally just a coffee tin that screams, then it's kind of like that hilarious old-fashioned prank where you open the can of peanuts and snakes jump out, except it's just a scream. And frankly, I would love to outsource my screaming to something that I can carry. Of just, you know, oh, ma'am, you need to... if someone's not maintaining social distance, say, then just... and then just close it back up, and that's my problem solved.
Which I get, because as a performer, you need to protect your voice. And yes. If you want to be able to, like, scare people away from you, it's like, they're like, I need to come in for a hug, because we used to work together at, like, the fucking Hollywood Video or something. And you're like, I need them, and you pop open that Folgers, and it's just like, yeah, they're just inundated with the fear of 1,000 ghosts, and it's like...
Like a human air horn, yeah.
Yeah, and at that, I think, I mean, there's a lot of value there, too, as a means of person deterrent. So,
but who would you harass creatively with a horny parrot?
My friends. Yeah. I mean, I would, because it's like if Ian likes birds. I could train a parrot to fly and come back to me, I'd be like, send it to Ian's house briefly and let it perch on his balcony and yell about all the dirty things it wants shoved in its cloaca, and then, like, you know, wait until he's streaming and do that and then just call it back. There's just lots of people where it's like, it would be fun to do that to them.
And how long does a parrot live, really? Like, how long would this parrot be our problem?
I have to be hundreds of years, I hope.
I suppose. Yeah. It depends on how great the thirst is.
So we got to make a choice, though. Which is the stronger option? Is pushing people away or pushing people away?
Right. Like... I would hope that the parrot responds to the name Sext, because that seems like an only... Hey, you're Sext. Yeah, what's up? I'm still on team Screaming Tin Can.
Then I will go with you on this journey.
Okay, thank you.
All right, then. I don't think we've ever had one of these scenarios where people have been like, you know, I might like more than one of these curse items.
That's if why I they have call to take items? Something... I have to take something.
You have to take something, but we've never had someone go, I could go for both.
There's just the method of, if I have to have something terrible with me, then I better get some utility out of it. Like, that's how Christmas works for me. Like, if you're going to give me a terrible gift, it may as well be useful.
And you have to use these things, too. The one reason I did not want that tub full of screams was because, as you mentioned, you don't have to ever open it. And if you don't open it, then it never screams, which means that you're denying a ghost the ability to scream. And when we die and turn to ghosts ourselves and meet that person on the astral realm, boy, are we in trouble then.
Mm.
I can't take care of a parrot. I can't take care of a tube.
No. No, it's too much responsibility. Whereas owning pornographic Garfield, canonically, would provide me with an excuse to get banned from Facebook and never have to deal with it ever again. Because if you have to use it, just use it as my avatar. Until somebody is finally like, this is inappropriate. And I'm like, sorry, I got banned off Facebook. Forever, I can't come to the class reunion. It's not my fault.
I honestly think that we could actually inject some much-needed fresh ideas into the Garfield regular canon with this information. Like, they've done two movies already. They're probably out of ideas. Well, if Garfield fucks now, that's a much better third movie. I cannot wait to hear Lorenzo Music doing that.
Lorenzo Music died.
Maybe he's in the can.
He's in his can.
Did you think of that, Paige?
That's settled.
If we have the ghost of Lorenzo Music screaming in agony or anger, I love the idea of anger, trapped in our coffee can, we have way more use, because to be able to be like, pop that shit open on Halloween and scare people and they'll be like, ah, is that Peter Venkman? Like, that kind of thing, I think, is like the two-step process you have to do to process, like, to get through that. I think that's a gift. It's a boon for mankind, ultimately.
I think you're just going to end up spending all your time explaining to people that you don't have Bill Murray in your can. And that's just going to be more frustrating.
But I think that immediately cushions the blow, having been screamed at by the inside of a tin can. Of just like, oh shit, Peter Venkman, hey, what's up?
Yeah.
I will wash my hands. Thanks.
Was that Carlton, the irony doorman?
The irony of it being the voice of Peter Venkman on the real Ghostbusters, then I think, you know, gives it its own novelty. So, yeah.
That is good marketable, work, everyone. Too. That's like, you could go to like Gen Con, because I'm assuming they're into that stuff there, and just be like, and now, Lorenzo Music! And that's like all you give them, right?
Just for an hour, that's the panel of just continuous, like those 10-hour-long ASMR videos on YouTube, just like unedited, no seams, 10 hours of Peter Venkman, maybe, or Lorenzo Music screaming.
Yeah, just this thing of like, I'll take the next question for Lorenzo Music, and it's like, what was it like working on Garfield and Friends? Okay, well, that's kind of encompasses that answer, I guess.
So, while the blue team has figured out a beautiful use for Lorenzo Music's voice in a can to scream at anti-maskers or just at conventions, the orange team has worked out a neat way to dodge around having to try to trick Facebook into allowing you to delete your own account by having them ban you by posting canonical Garfield erotica. So I think this round is a tie as we move on to our last question. Good news. Penny Arcade and Reed Pop have hired you as a consultant to ask for assistance in selecting a new convention center for when PAX someday returns to the meat space. But civic bylaws being what they are, certain concessions must be made. Once everything gets through City Council, you will be able to offer a PAX location with either a baffling labyrinth of a convention center, nowhere near hotels, but surrounded by amazing and affordable restaurants that can comfortably accommodate large numbers. 2, a cramped and joyless convention center with zero natural light in an utter desert of food options, but attached to numerous cheap and comfortable hotels. Or 3, a convention center nowhere near places to sleep or places to eat or public transportation, but a convention center that is innately navigable, easily walkable, is resplendent with comfortable seating, features odorless bathrooms, and is acoustically perfect. Team, this one.
I feel like the third option is literally just the Boston Convention Center.
Yeah, I think these are all based on true stories. My concern about the last option is if it is truly just this kind of oasis of a convention center in the middle of just no other accommodations, people are just going to find a way to sleep there, and then PAX will just become sort of a pop-up city. And yeah, I don't think that's the last thing we need. That's some Fury Road shit.
So is it better to have food or better to have a place to go back to that's real close? I feel like hotels are almost a better option because it's more expensive than me eating.
Yeah, and I think you can't underestimate the importance of a midday nap during a convention. The ability to just... because. Speaking as someone who's usually at Dragon Con, that's the entire appeal of Dragon Con, is you can tap out at any moment and just go lay down in the dark. Otherwise, it would not be survivable as an environment.
So if we are near hotels, then our host, can you tell us again what the convention center was like that's attached to this?
A cramped and joyless convention center with zero natural light in an utter desert of food options.
So that's the PAX South Convention Center.
Yeah. Well, and it's... in my experience, like from what I remember of the PAX show floor, it's a lot of cramped and dark with no natural light anyway. Usually they provide their own light and it's like usually green and red and there's, you know, giant models of robots that are making noise and you're standing in line waiting to, you know, play a PC demo for 2 minutes. Like, you don't need windows. We're not a group that values natural light anyway.
The vendors... the presenters, whatever you want to call them, the people on the show floor would prefer that they can control for light and sound because they're there to make it a aesthetically oppressive experience a lot of the time. Please stop bringing neon lights and to the show floor. Nobody needs it as much as you think we do. So that's us, cramped and oppressive, I guess.
Cramped and joyless, but you can nap whenever.
I will briefly defend PAX South Beach because, in terms of food options, because you
That's true.
Utter desert of food is right by the Riverwalk, which has a lot.
I meant more just the convention center itself. It's just kind of this weird L-shaped thing that doesn't have a lot of natural light in any of the spaces. So
that's fair.
Yeah.
So for Cameron and Ian, are you looking for a convention center that is just the most pleasant building to be in, or near excellent and ample food?
I'm going to call the first option. And not for the reason you may think, but because I want to explore this hideous, hellish, labyrinthine convention center that echoes and has terrible lighting. I think that sounds interesting in a Borgesian sense, right? Like, you'll just be walking along, and suddenly you'll see people walking along the wall, and they'll look at you, and you're like, I don't know, it said fifth floor, and they're like, oh, we're on the third floor.
But they're above you, and they're walking on the wall.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And you're trying to get, like, you're standing in line for, like, a demo of a game that will be out in 2 weeks, but you've been in it for 6 years. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you just take a step to the left, and suddenly you're in a lineup for a subway. And since that sucks, you can just get out of that lineup and go and have, like, some really nice dumplings somewhere. Wouldn't that be nice? Because it's a trackless, dimensionless labyrinth, you just stand up and you're already back in line.
It's perfect.
For a different game.
Like, we already know what's going to be at these conventions when we go to them. It's written in guidebooks. It's announced beforehand. It's why you go and you just go through the motions of what you've planned before. This introduces serendipity to it. You can be walking down a hallway that suddenly just comes to a door that you didn't realize and architecturally shouldn't be there. What's on the other side? Is it a room full of dice vendors? Is it a brand new game? Is it just a singular large sumo cushion that you have no hope of actually scaling and sitting upon? Who can tell? But I want to find out.
This is already an inherently disorienting, draining experience. Why not lean into it? Why not, in fact, make it the prime attraction?
Mm-hmm. Oh, the big joke, PAX goes on forever? Well, yes, now it does, both temporally mm-hmm. and physically.
Do you, because I am being waved at by someone in the back of this mythical convention hall that we're holding this panel in, Does Team PAX West have any further thoughts to their convention center choice?
I would think if
go ahead.
I would think if there's no restaurants nearby, you know, because normally the restaurant nearest the convention center is the one that has a, you know, 150-minute wait. But if everybody has to sort of go on the Oregon Trail to get to their food options, then you really carefully pick who you're gonna go to a meal with. And you don't just kind of get gate crashed by randos. The premise of this question unearths all of the things I didn't like about being at PAX in the meets. So thank God for PAX Cyber. What were you going to say, Pete?
I agree with the sense of that. If all the hotels are close, I could either cheat and find a supermarket somewhere, and if I have to catch like a taxi and go and just. Because I do this a lot of the times anyways, just go buy food and pack whatever fridge might be in my hotel so I can just have that. So I could cheat. Mm-hmm. But if I want to respect the spirit of this, that I have to eat all my things at a hotel or at the restaurants that are at least a 30 to 40 minute walk away, I guess that's better to be like, I'll go for the walk. I don't enjoy it. And I'll eat. But hopefully the restaurants are like, if they're all spread out in all different directions, does that not mean that there's a better chance that by picking a random direction, I'll just end up at a place that maybe only has about a 45 to 60 minute wait, which is, you know, I can deal with, versus I have a cheap hotel? Because if I'm in a place that has a lot of great food, but I am in this expensive ass hotel that's way off in the boonies, I'm always going back the same way every night, and it's going to take me 2 hours to get to my hotel room. It's like, I'm not willing to put up with that. I will just sleep under the Bandland table at that point.
Mm-hmm. Which I believe was the...
And you have...
Oh, go ahead, Molly.
Oh, you have enough time in your, you know, 45-minute journey to the restaurant to just open a table for when you get there. That's been my con experience, and it's honestly my favorite thing to just walk in and be like, table for me, please. then it, you, I don't know, you look like the one adult in the room that remembered that you have to eat to keep your body awake during a con.
Are we over time? I'm sorry.
We should wrap things up. So, you know, maybe you can pester Beach on Twitter for his further PAX thoughts, I suppose.
I'm never going back, clearly. They're never going to invite me.
I want to give some props to Team PAX Unplugged for their turning the Labyrinthine Convention Center into a fourth dimensional exploratory Herb-X.
If I may say, Grim.
Experience,
when you,
yes.
When you enter the PAX Cube, welcome home forever. There is no need to sleep because sleep is death. And if you feel you need to eat, well, you better find something quick because night's coming and it's time for the concerts.
That's what it says in the back of the badge.
Good Lord. And however, props to Team PAX Very Plugged In for that absolute life hack, Molly, of just reserving a table for one. That's brilliant, and I love it. So before we get to the final scores, I want to thank everybody for watching, and I want to thank our panelists for being here and doing all of the talking to Ian and Cameron and Beej and myself, who are a part of Loading Ready Run, who you can find at twitch.tv/loadingreadyrun, and more of the panelists at youtube.com/loadingreadyrun. Shoutouts to Molly, who you can find on Twitch at MollyLele. That's MollyLele. Correct me if that is incorrect.
Yes, it is.
Fantastic. And thank you, Molly, for being here. And thanks to PAX for letting us do this. But I do see from the scores that, indeed, there are no winners and there is no prize. This has been the panelists. Thank you for watching.